Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this evening's webinar, Reflections on Rowing the Atlantic. I'm Robert Allen, APM Branches Manager. I'm delighted that you could join us tonight. I hope this finds you all well. You'll find yourselves in listen-only mode, but that's not to say that we don't want your interaction tonight. If you have any questions, please feel free to submit this via your control panel, and time-dependent, I'll read these out to Rich at the end. I would personally like to say thank you to the APM Yorkshire and North Lincolnshire branch for making this event happen. And on that note, I'd like to pass over to Andrew, the chair of the branch, to introduce our keynote speaker, Rich Hall.
Thanks very much, Rob, and welcome everybody. I've got a great pleasure in introducing Lieutenant Colonel Rich Hall. Colonel Rich was educated at Loughborough University and commissioned into the Duke of Wellington in 1997, which later became part of the Yorkshire Regiment. He trained and qualified as a jungle warfare instructor in the tropics of Brunei and Belize, and then made his first operational overseas deployment in Kosovo, and then went on to serve on the front line in Iraq and in Afghanistan. And while in Afghanistan, was awarded the MBE for his endeavours in helping plan and draw down the extraction from the country. He was then promoted to Lieutenant Colonel and remained in a logistics-focused role as Chief of Staff for 101 Log Brigade in Aldershot, and rewrote the doctrine on sustaining an armoured division. And in 2017, he assumed command of the Army Foundation College in Harrogate and focused his efforts on championing the opportunities afforded to young people on enlisting in the Army, developing a world-class narrative. In this tenure, the college was declared Ofsted Outstanding and delivered record low wastage rates and became the first smoke-free site in the British Army, and broke the record for the most amount of money raised by a charity, for charity by a unit, and secured two civilian leadership qualifications for its trainees. And it was while serving at the Army Foundation College that Colonel Rich skippered in 2019 the Army's first team row of the Atlantic Ocean, and qualifying one of the college's recent graduates as a double world record holder and raising £40,000 for the ABF Soldiers Charity in the process. And that's why we're here this evening, is to listen to Colonel Rich talk about his experience of planning, preparing, and then rowing the Atlantic in that adventure. And I think what we'll find is that there's tremendous parallels in the discipline of project management between what they do in the military and what we do as professional project managers in our careers. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Colonel Rich and hand over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. Good evening, everyone. Thank you to the Association for Project Management for inviting me just to share a few stories and, I suppose, anecdotes that might contribute towards your understanding of project management. So we rode the Atlantic almost a year ago that we set off. And I think the first thing to say is that it was certainly a project rather than just an adventure, and a project in the traditional sense of the word. It had it was time bound, it had a budget, it had competing aims, deliverables, it required us to manage risk, to engage with stakeholders. And I think, like a lot of projects that people have on the go, it wasn't our main job, it wasn't my main role. It was, I suppose, a hobby that increasingly required more and more of my time and energy and focus. And I think that's something that's probably interesting to touch on going through it, just how much of it, in some ways, a distraction it was from the main job of commanding the college. So I've got a few slides to show you. There are some messages about selecting and maintaining an aim of a project. There's a bit on the mental resilience of rowing and how that might apply when you get through some pretty difficult challenges. And also just, I think, stories of camaraderie and overcoming difficulties. And we had quite a few of those along the way. So bear with me for the technology. This may or may not work, but we shall see. Rob will keep me on the straight and narrow. The first thing I want to show you is probably a picture from my childhood. And I put this up because I want you to understand the row, although it was an arduous physical challenge, and we did it as a military team, something like that isn't an overtly military activity. Now, of course, we're trained to plan, and we have our own military decision-making process. And I think by dint of uniformed service, people assume that we do these sorts of things all the time. And actually, that's not true. And I suppose to debunk a few myths about the military, I say I wanted to share a picture of my childhood. And you look at that and think, well, there you go. There's you as a seven-year-old always wanting to be a soldier. So it's probably always been in the blood. But that's actually not me. That's my brother. This was us preparing for a fancy dress costume when we lived in Wales. There was my outfit, my mum kindly made. So, I had no interest in joining the army or the military at all until really late on, so post-university, trying to figure out what to do next and what to do with myself. So I've never really thought of myself as a traditional army man, and I've never considered myself one of these adventurers that goes climbing and trekking to remote parts of the world. I think for me, this rowing project came about for a completely different reason. And that's why, from a project management sense, I feel this is far more of a snapshot, time-bound, resource-constrained project in time than some sort of romantic, challenging endeavour. So where it all came about was while I was commanding the Army Foundation College, as Andrew mentioned. It's an amazing place if you've not heard of it. I mean, you probably haven't. It's not particularly well understood. But it's the only establishment like it in the world. It trains over 1,000 teenagers each year to become soldiers. And Britain is the country that recruits its soldiers at the youngest. So it's the only establishment really that deals entirely with teenage military recruits. Training is pretty intense. They're there for a year. It's almost like the soldier version of the Royal Military Academy Sandhurst. And apart from the military training, they do a lot of education. It's resetting years of failed schooling for some of these youngsters. They do leadership training, sports and skills. And actually, it made me think just what an amazing sort of platform for social mobility and life skills and general advancement that it was. Now, at the time I was there, the Army launched this new recruiting campaign, which you may have seen, and it focused on the pejorative labels that my generation, I guess, applied to teenagers about being phone addicts and selfie zombies and that kind of thing. And it was saying that the Army saw beyond these labels and it saw the potential in everyone. And I really subscribed to that. And I think this trying to play on people's self-belief was really important. At the same time, we hosted a TV documentary called Raw Recruits, Squaddies at 16. A bit of a nerve-wracking time. That was an embedded film crew with us for 6 months of our lives, almost free access to every single thing that we did and said. But the product was great, and we were really proud of the fact they were showing a really accurate portrayal of what army life was like, but actually more importantly, what the change and transformation that young soldiers went through whilst at the college. So to cut a long story short, we wanted to capitalize on this momentum. We wanted to support army recruiting, and we wanted to shout more overtly about what the college was doing. And in our own way, we tried to decide on something that was quite eye-catching, something that would speak to the quality of young people in the military and those that aspire to join, and perhaps something unique that would capture people's imagination. So we decided that we would enter into the Talisker Whisky Atlantic Challenge, a transatlantic rowing race, 3,000 miles across the North Atlantic Ocean. It had been done before, but we wanted to make a statement about our junior soldiers. So we decided that the key component, the key member of the team, was going to be a junior soldier. Now, we ran an internal selection procedure. There were 100 crazy young men and women that stuck their hand up and volunteered for a seat in the boat. And we whittled it down to the final one, which was 17-year-old Kian Helm from Lancashire. A pretty, unremarkable in many ways young man. He'd left school with no qualifications, joined the army, probably as a career of last resort rather than first choice, and certainly had no other aspiration than to get through training, get into his regiment and just embark on his career as a soldier. So when this chance came along, we're really chuffed that he put his hand up and volunteered. And through the selection procedure, he became the most viable candidate. I wouldn't say he was particularly strong in any area, but he was a good all-rounder. And actually, we thought he had the most important characteristic, which was sort of the mental resilience and the ability just to keep going under difficult circumstances. The rest of us, we were instructors at the college. So I was the boss, I led it, but I asked two of my captains to come with me on the journey. So on the picture on the left, we've got very far left, Alex, who's a young cavalry captain, very strong, very analytical, took 2 weeks to come back to me with the answer about whether he was going to join us. And on the far right, Chris, sort of about my age, lots of experience, lots of operational tours under his belt, in the physical training corps, and he'd accepted before I'd even explained what it is that we were doing. So quite a diverse team in an army sense, but a team that I suppose was more corporate than virtually every other of the 35 teams that entered the race that year, because we weren't friends. We were brought together by a shared common interest and profession, but we didn't have years of sports clubs or socializing or anything else really to fall back on. And part of our project management, therefore, became focused on forming a bond as a team that was going to survive the rigors of the North Atlantic Ocean in December. So the race itself, I call it a race. I suppose it is a race, but people enter it for all sorts of different reasons. But it sets off from the Canary Islands, a place called La Gomera, and it goes with the trade winds and the currents across to Antigua, so 3,000 nautical miles. We planned on the crossing taking 40 days, but it really was completely weather dependent. Some of the boats, although we set off in December and finished late January, some of the boats traditionally don't finish until the end of March, certainly for the solos and the pairs that obviously have less sort of physical horsepower to propel them through it. But quite a challenge, and I think the remoteness of it and the fact that after the start line we didn't see a single boat, and we only saw two tankers on the whole crossing and not a single contrail, quite a lonely isolated journey for us four from North Yorkshire. So the boat itself, as a little picture of it, 7 meters long, a cabin at either end made of fiberglass, really buoyant. I think the manufacturer said if you chop the boat in half you just have two very ocean rowing boats, so it wouldn't actually sink unless it was sort of physically destroyed by an object. So we were pretty confident that we were safe as long as we were in the boat. I suppose the key risk, therefore, the biggest risk in all of this, was becoming detached from the boat. So we were pretty paranoid, pretty safety conscious. We were always harnessed to it. But in some ways, yeah, it's little, it gets tossed about. It's at the mercy of the sea, but it's also that cabin at either end is like a little life capsule. And we did think a lot of it, a lot of the times we thought about the analogy of a space capsule. And it was that attention to detail of keeping ourselves clipped on and safe that, again, was a key part of our safety plan. In terms of just talking you through some of the key aspects of how we got across, you know, the food was all freeze-dried rations. So add boiling water to it, it hydrates, and you can eat it about 10 minutes later. So pretty lightweight, and you can cram a lot of that food in the hollow compartments of the boat. The toilet was pretty uninspiring. No ensuite facilities. It was a simple bucket and chuck it concept. The water came from a water maker, so a fantastic bit of kit that turned seawater into drinking water. And I don't mean sort of salty brine equivalent drinkable water, actual really pure tasting, like you'd buy from a supermarket bottled water stuff. It was really impressive, but a kit that never let us down once. Comms kit, so we had three GPS systems for redundancy. We had satellite phones. We had a way of, through an electronic map, understanding where we were so we could navigate properly. And then an auto helm that controlled the rudder. So we could just set the direction that we wanted the boat to go in, and it would do its best to keep it going in that direction. And obviously the sort of key safety equipment. So we had a life raft on board. We had immersion suits, emergency rations, personal locator beacons. But actually, as I mentioned, that the boat itself was probably the safest thing that we were carrying with us. So I think only in an absolute disaster situation did we ever imagine getting off that thing. So in terms of how we got ourselves ready, this was I suppose 24 months at the outset, but 18 months in detail of planning, preparing and training for this crossing. And we did anything and everything that we thought would one, make us safe, and two, give us a little bit of an edge against our competitors. So lots of technical training, the technical rowing training, but also technical physical development preparation. So you see a picture of Kian there with, you know, going right back to basics for lifting techniques. So we're focused on how to build muscle to prevent injury. We focused on map reading, navigation, survival at sea, first aid specific at sea. And then we turned inwardly to focus on ourselves and our personalities and our mental resilience. So we undertook an equivalent of personality testing, which gave us an insight into how we like to be communicated to, which I found invaluable as a skipper. And there was a real difference in, at the end of that, how I approached presenting information or giving tasks to the other team members, depending on the results of the program that we'd been through. Then we did a bit of rock climbing, abseiling, skydiving, things that we thought that we would perhaps need in terms of arming ourselves against the rigors of the sea, and in some ways insulating us against some of the fear factor to help us make decisions under pressure. And then we also had a sort of wider campaign wrap that revolved around social media and branding, and getting our, I suppose, our corporate image in the right place. And I do smile as I look at the pictures of our hoodies on there. I remember we went to Gosport for our yachting, so sailing expedition. So we did a week sailing just to get used to the sea. And we were wearing our hoodies for the first time. And we were staying in the mess at Gosport, the All Ranks mess. And we'd gone in for breakfast on the first day. And a lady that worked there came over and said, what are you guys here for? And I sort of remember pushing my chair back and feeling really proud, stroking my top and saying to her that, we're rowing the Atlantic next year. And she went, oh, does that mean you're back in for lunch then or not? It was a real come down, and you made me realize that not everyone perhaps is quite into the project in the same way that you are. But on the whole, I think people were interested in what we're doing. I mentioned the technical training. This is just a bit of video with no sound. It's taken off the coast of Hartlepool, where we did most of our training. It's a little bit jerky, but it just gives you a sense of perhaps the instability of the boat and how it moves through the water. But for probably 80% of what we wanted, that was fine. Understanding our way around the boat, understanding how it maneuvers, what the wind does to it. The key shortcoming, though, was that you can imagine that the waves, the sea state off the coast of Hartlepool is nowhere near like it was going to be mid-Atlantic. So it never really gave us a taste in that sense for, I suppose, what surfing down the back of some of the bigger waves and what the squalls were going to do to us. But it did give us an insight into seasickness. And in the same day, even that sea state is pretty calm. 10 minutes out to sea, Kian starts to feel pretty ill. And he went rapidly downhill from there and contributed virtually nothing to the day's training that day. But again, I suppose I'd never experienced it at this point. Heard about it, knew it was debilitating, but seeing what it can do to a crew member and how it affected his thought process and his logic. And shortly after I took this picture, he actually wanted to get off and swim to shore. He felt that rough. So it did, at the back of my mind, make me think that, yeah, we were going to have to really arm ourselves and think and drill ourselves against what seasickness can actually do to us. So a nod to project management. This was our version of trying to break down the various elements of what was going to make us successful. You don't need to read the squares in detail, but in broad chunks, if you can divide it into the three columns separated by the dotted lines, you've got a really big, thick column on the left. a slim one in the middle and a slightly bigger one to the right. It's probably no surprise to you that the biggest column was everything that we did before we hit the start line. So it was about anything from getting the authority to do the race itself, which broke all sorts of army policy, for procuring the boat and equipment, for our own technical preparation, our own physical and mental preparation, the media, the PR, the fundraising for charity, and then finally the sponsors. It was easily 70% of the overall campaign. And there were several milestones moving left to right that were critical. I know there's all sorts of charts and ways of describing it, and we had our own simple version, but I think there are some critical points about fundraising. There are some critical points about getting ourselves qualified in time, and probably mental milestones that we had to satisfy that we were going to gel as a team by the time that we'd finished our sea training. Otherwise, you know, maybe we weren't fit to go as a team. You see, the bit in the middle was the row itself. Most of that focused on our values, our standards, our respect for each other, and what was going to make us gel as a team. And then everything on the right-hand side was, I think, really geared around the exploitation of this to give a little bit back for the army that had, you know, kindly given us the time to go and do it in the first place. And I think one of the things I found really interesting was the engagement with sponsors. So at least 90% of the funding for this came through corporate sponsorship. The army gave us a little bit for subsistence, for food and fuel around the UK, but a really enjoyable part came selling the concept, selling the idea to sponsors and asking them to get behind it. And I suppose for a little while I got this wrong. I mean, we generated a lot of sponsorship, but I realized that dealing with sponsors wasn't so much a transactional thing. They weren't buying what we were doing. They were buying why we were doing it. And I think once the penny dropped with me, it helped shape my pitch, and it helped me in terms of talking about the reason why. And I suppose in terms of landing an idea, it's a really important concept to understand. But yeah, we had, I think, 85 sponsors overall, some demanding, some less so. But we really wanted to give back to them and also make them feel part of the journey by communicating with them regularly. So that became a very big part of our campaign. I also enjoyed seeing the thing come to life. It was ages before we actually got hands on the boat. And this was one of the first sort of professional-ish concept drawings that I did on PowerPoint, and trying to visualize where the sponsors' logos were going to go. And actually then seeing this thing in the flesh, almost identical to that picture, it was a hugely uplifting moment. I've always had a bit of a bent for graphical design, but if seeing a concept go through the modeling stage into reality, it was brilliant for us. And the boat looked beautiful out on the water as well. So yeah, I really, really enjoyed that part of it. So I think my first sort of reflecting on project management lesson is something that you will have no doubt heard about, this management strategy about failing fast to succeed quickly. That really, really applied to us. Yeah, we were embarking on a project that none of us had any experience of. We couldn't afford to sit down and spend ages trying to theorize and strategize and contingency plan against what would or wouldn't work. And that's the way the army does normally like to do business, because failing in the army is catastrophic, particularly in operations. So we plan against it. We couldn't afford it. So we threw ourselves into this, and it made it really uncomfortable, in that we would make lots of mistakes. We had to keep reminding ourselves it was trial and error. We had to keep reminding ourselves when something didn't work, that failure was as important as if something had worked. And we were always pushing the boundary of things that we weren't very good at. I used to hate people watching us launch the boat or row, because we'd always be trying to do something that we hadn't done before. But I think that was a really good way for us to figure out, through our sort of amateurish attempts, broadly what was going to work and what was going to work for us most importantly. So then we got to the start line almost a year ago. As I mentioned, we set off on the 1st of December last year. The race started on the 12th, and it really is this incredible sort of carnival atmosphere with an undercurrent of nerves and trepidation. But it's a little bit like the cross between a Formula One pit lane with all these beautiful boats lined up in their own colour schemes and sponsors plastered everywhere. But also the community is really warm and open and engaging. And I think willing to talk about what they'd done and how they were doing it. And again, and in the project management sense, every single one of these boats and their crews had been through the same sort of process. So they just wanted to talk and I think share experiences and understand how each other had done it. I think there's something in the collaboration between teams that is a genuinely nice element of this row, that no one wanted to see anyone else fail. Yes, there was a bit of competition, but it was all really healthy. And actually the community itself was superb. So we did a few testers from this. We were allowed sort of to take the boat out into the sea and have a little play around in the bigger waves. But this was really about sort of farewell to family, packing the boat for the final time, and then getting myself into the right mental state to get going. I must say, so the first week, once we were off, once we'd passed the fanfare of the start line, I'll show you a video clip of that in a moment. We were into this first week, and crikey, it was a real baptism of fire. We set up into 40 knot winds, which the race organisers had briefed us about comprehensively, and we were sort of nervous laughing about the strength of the wind and the size of the sea. But actually, it wasn't until we escaped the lee of the land and started to experience it that we, I think, realised just what, I suppose, how far out of our comfort zones we were actually going with no turning back. It was really noticeable that the first time water came over the deck, there we got wet feet, and that would never really happened in training. And then it was hitting us sort of knee high, and then hitting us in the hips and knocking us off our seats. And you notice the crew dynamic changes, that people stop laughing, they go quiet, and they start to really take it seriously and almost holding on for dear life at certain points. And then the first nightfall, crikey, I think we probably hadn't even thought about what it would be like rowing in the pitch black. And it was genuinely pitch black. You couldn't see more than sort of halfway down the oar. The moon wasn't out, there was clouds, you couldn't see the stars. It was a very, very disorientating experience, particularly in such a big sea where waves are breaking over the boat. And while you can hear them coming, you can't see them. So it was a real, I think the first 24 hours, at times I thought maybe even the race organisers would call it off and they'd bring us back in, and then catching myself thinking, what a ridiculous thing to think. This is a one-way journey. There is no stopping. There is no going back. We just have to deal with whatever nature throws at us. And you can see some of the grimacing on the slides. This was seasickness kicking in. It ruined our appetite. Nobody ate for the first sort of 3 days. Hands started to get sore. Backside starting to get hot spots, as we call them. So I think it was a difficult start, compounded for us by probably a poorer start than others had had. You know, we really struggled to understand how the boat was going to manoeuvre properly in the sea and the wind. And we were, I think at the end of the first 24 hours, we were in 19th place of 35 teams, not where we imagined a British Army team to be. I'll show you this picture, because it's difficult to bring the size of the sea to life. But because waves are all sort of in relation to each other, but this is a really good example of what they call sort of a rogue wave, or where a wave can come out of sort of nowhere on what looks like a calm sea. And I think this picture, you can see the wave behind it and the yacht dipping down into a trough. These are pretty common. And because they travel so quickly, you look around and it's relatively calm. And the next thing, this is upon you. So I don't know, I think of all the pictures I've seen, although that's not an ocean rowing boat, it does give a sense of how the ocean is just, you can never really relax. It lulls you into a false sense and then will take advantage of you if you ever take your eye off it for a moment. To bring the first 24 hours to life, this is the boat track after, yeah, I suppose a very difficult first night. And you can see some of the boats on the top left actually struck back for La Gomera. They decided they had enough. They never made it, and they turned around and carried on rowing. But you got Mad Giraffe top right, who had a crazy old time all the way across. And you can see our boat highlighted in pink sort of around the middle. But it just goes to show, I think, that the havoc that the weather was causing with the boats. And again, sort of unprecedented conditions for the race to set off in. I think had the weather happened maybe a week in, we'd have coped with it a lot better. But yeah, tricky old first start. And I'll also show you this clip, which is the only video of a capsize that anyone's managed to capture so far. So this is Gabby, one of the solo rowers. So you see the absolute requirement to be clipped on at all times. Okay, so I'm going to share part one of the video. Just bear with me.
This is our first video from La Gomera. We made it.
How you feeling then? All right?
Confident, yeah. I'm well. Just want to go on.
How are you liking the new stash?
It's better than our stash, to be honest. That's
what?
Knocking it.
What do you mean?
Hearty shot.
I think we're on our third day on the Talisker Whisky Atlantic Challenge 2019. Haven't really done much filmmakers, boy, it has been rough. The crew, I think we've all been sick. Still suffering a bit of seasickness, no appetite whatsoever. Since race start, oh, I can't even think about it. I don't know, I can't even think what I've eaten. Just, oh. Oh, we just had a pretty rough night, really. Strong winds, big waves, relentless, driving south. No other option, just to keep going.
We've all been seasick, not just me for once.
We GoPro'd the bottom of the boat yesterday, and there's like a little ecosystem under there, so we're going to get our bathing costumes on, and
we are cleaning the bottom of the boat. It's not the best of conditions to clean the boat in, but it'll do.
Gotta hold on.
There's nothing much to see other than these two lunatics in the water.
So So I get asked a lot about the mental resilience required, and you know, how do we develop it, and how do we cope when we're on the boat? And I suppose I've done a lot of reflecting about the Army's approach to mental resilience as a whole, actually. And I'll show you this slide, because this is taken from the sort of Army Mental Resilience Handbook, and it describes the different pillars that I probably distill into, I think, four things, which is about having control at least of an element of what you're trying to do. And even if you think things are spiraling out of control, you can take several steps back. And as long as you grip a part of it and then go again, it helps you anchor, and that sort of guards against that feeling of helplessness. I think having positivity, you know, you've got to have a positive effect on others around you, but having that positive mindset, almost being a sort of slight optimist, I think really helps. You've got to have belief in the project as well. You've got to have belief that in the reason why you're doing something, and that then spills into the trust in your teammates, and also trust in yourself to be a good member of a team. So whether you're leading a team or being part of a team, you know, it works both ways. So all of those are very, I suppose, very soft. They're all very centered around people and mindsets and strategies. They're not born of exposing yourself to danger. They're not born of hardship. They're not born of pushing yourself out of a comfort zone in a way of almost trying to inoculate you against stress further down the line. And I think this is a really important point for mental resilience in everyday life. And had I perhaps realized that, and certainly were I to do this again, I wouldn't be jumping out of planes skydiving. I'd be investing in my team to make sure that we generated that sense of purpose that people bought into, to make sure that we supported each other as team members, and that we had coping strategies for each other tailored to our personalities. So it's all those sorts of things. So I think, you know, mental resilience with great teamwork and knowing your place as an individual within that team, and as a leader, making sure people are valued and they fit, is a fantastic way of guarding against those, I suppose, you know, factors that will start to gnaw away and sow the seeds of doubt with people. So I think, I don't know, that was, whether you find it useful, that my take on it from a military man is that mental resilience is about teamwork, positivity, self-belief and attitudes. It's not about courage and being able to perform under duress. Okay, so once that first week of the row was done, I guess we got into our stride a little bit. To give you a sense of what it was like on the boat, we rowed for 2 hours and then we had 2 hours off. So that was it, day and night, 2 hours on, 2 hours off for the 37 days that it took us to get across. And I remember thinking when we were talking to people about it, yeah, 2 hours on, 2 hours off. We've been in the military, used to getting up at silly o'clock in the morning. But the reality of it was completely different. And I would say it's probably the hardest thing I've ever had to do from a self-discipline perspective, is to keep getting up, keep obeying that alarm clock, putting your wet clothes on, and going out on deck in the rain to take over from your partner. So to not be late, to do it with a sort of cheery smile, to have a positive attitude, and actually to do all the things around that to protect you as a rower, to look after yourself, to feed yourself, to administer yourself, look after your feet, tend to your sores, all those sorts of things, when actually what your body's screaming out for is just to lay down and go to sleep. And I think that was a really, really hard thing to do, and actually to encourage Kian, who really struggled with that element of it as well, to keep doing. There's lots of jobs to do on the boat. I say 2 hours off. If it was 2 hours of sleep, it would have been been bliss. But actually, we all had our jobs to do. I had to particular focus on navigation, and I was in communications with our brilliant lady back in the UK called Dawn Wood, who helped us with our bearings, was fastidious about looking at the weather and helping us sort of pick our way between the storms, but also cleaning the boat. You saw us get off and clean the underneath of it, but cleaning the tops, keeping the solar panels clear, making water for the day, tending to the seat bearings that took a real battering. And actually the process of cooking and eating and, you know, keeping in touch with people and writing our little diaries and that kind of thing, it eats into your 2 hours. So I think probably in every 24-hour period, I would get about 2 hours sleep in the night shifts and about an hour sleep in the day shifts. So 3 hours in every 24. Actually, that was, for me, I felt that was relatively sustainable. I had my moments at night where I'd really struggle and want to fall asleep. But most of the time, I think, certainly during the day, I could cope with it. We had some quite interesting psychological experiences, I guess. I would micro-sleep. So I'd fall asleep whilst on the recovery stroke, and then my oar hitting the water would wake me up. And I go through this for like a 40-minute period. It would be like a little mini heart attack each time the oar hit the water and it would jerk me awake. Chris hallucinated quite a lot with tiredness. And he talks about how he saw someone jog past the boat at 2 a.m. and he didn't think how ridiculous that someone could be running on water, or even that the fact there'd be another person out at sea, but just looking at his watch thinking, what a strange time to go running. So everyone had their own strange dreams and odd experiences. But I think by and large, as a crew, we were able to laugh about them rather than actually start to worry about what this thing was doing to us. I think the bodies held up relatively well. We had really painful hands. Chris still now can't make a fist with his hands, and this is almost a year after the event. It's called claw hand, but I think that the constant tension in the rowing position affects people differently, but he's really struggled with that. I got a few sores on my backside that is inevitable, but apart from that, wasn't too bad. But I think just general fatigue and weight loss, and we could actually see in each other, not so much ourselves, but we could see in each other the weight just starting to strip away. You'll see a picture of Chris at the end. He lost 16 kilograms on the row, and looks actually very, very ill by the end of it. And to be honest, he was ill a couple of times during the row and struggled with eating throughout. But there were some amazing highlights. I think the wildlife was particularly impressive. We saw flying fish all the time. We saw marlin, as you can see in the picture. We had a hammerhead shark around the boat. We heard whales breathing at night, and lots of seabirds, a surprising amount of seabirds. Almost in perpetuity were there seabirds around us. But I think, I take away some of the majesty and the romance of it all as well. I mean, we had so many laughs on the boat. We used to have this thing of, we call it T-Rex arms, where you'd be laughing so much, your strength would just leave you. And all you could do is put your oars on your knees and just kind of belly laugh until whatever inane thing you were laughing at had gone away. Exacerbated by tiredness, probably a little bit like drunkenness. But there were some really, really funny moments on the boat that would mean nothing if I said them to you now. But I think we do look back on it fondly and break out laughing just thinking about them even now. Right, I'll play the next little video clip and see if this works.
But everything's good on the boat at the minute. Everything's, morale's high.
I struggle to find any truth in your lies.
My happy face.
Feels like forever.
Yeah, I've been hit by flying fish. Chris hit a dolphin on the head with his oar blade.
2 hours on, 2 hours off of that.
Christmas morning then.
What do you think Santa's brought you?
There is Antigua. So we're actually getting close to the middle now, which is great.
So yeah,
we're all feeling good. Well, apart from Chris. Chris is feeling like death warmed up.
But he's still going, bless him. Look at him.
Oh, I can't wait till you get back on form. It's killing me. I almost feel sorry for you.
Yeah, I don't feel sorry for you.
How tired are you feeling right now?
I've got a bloody tummy ache now.
He's got a tummy ache. Bless him.
Oh, you've got a poorly.
Poorly tum tum.
It's alright, we're all tied down here. Take my soul.
How fickle my heart and how
we've seen some dolphins already. That was quite cool.
I struggle to find any truth in your lies. And now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I must finally show. Body.
On shark watch, we've got a hammerhead shark trailing the boat, about 2 meters long. Just make out the shadow of the water. The other side of Kian's tiny flat backside. Oh! So as expected, the hammerhead returned back to us. We always knew it was going to happen. Richard's floundering on the oars was going to attract predators one way or another. And yeah, the hammerhead came back. Swam around for a bit. We tried to bait it with biltong. So our next step is we're going to lather Kian up with peanut butter, have him clench a pepperoni between his cheeks, and see if he'll take that. Check back in a bit.
Changed, if I'm honest. Still in a boat, still rowing. I'm enjoying bits of it, hating other bits. I think that's only natural.
So the final bit now, I appreciate we're sort of running out of time, but I just I'll put this slide up because this is probably the most dangerous point for us in the race. We were in fourth at this point. We'd just managed to sneak ahead of the Navy, the Royal Navy that had entered the competition for the first time as well. And I say dangerous because it's all about the aims of the campaign. And two of us on the boat really wanted to race and compete and go for the win. And two wanted to make sure that we got across in good order. And I think it leads me on to, in terms of project management, the thing that the Army calls selection and maintenance of the aim. So having a really, really clear understanding of why you're doing something and what it is you're trying to achieve. For our row, there were multiple competing objectives, and I've tried to divide them into the sort of strategic, team and individual level. At the strategic level, we had to not fail as an Army team. We could not have come home having not completed the task when other civilian teams had done it. And you can imagine the Army ethos about not failing something. But we also wanted to support Army recruiting. The whole reason we were doing this was to showcase how impressive young men and women are that join the Army. Well, had we failed, we wouldn't have done that. At the team level, we wanted to secure a world record for Kian of being the fastest youngster across the ocean. We wanted to beat the Navy in that kind of service camaraderie. But we also wanted to, I think, as I mentioned, pay back something to our sponsors who supported us so generously. And at an individual level, it's that anything and everything from, you know, why do you climb a mountain? Because it's there, through to the sort of competition and adventure. And for me personally, raising money for charity was quite a big part of the campaign. So throw all that into the mix. There was a danger that we'd have all had our own individual motivations, and that wouldn't have been unified as a team. But we decided that, you know, being professional and not failing was the most important thing for us. You know, we had to secure this picture at the end. That was what it was all about. So I mentioned that previous slide about the most dangerous point. Had we not agreed that really clearly at the start, that could have pulled the team apart. When we were tired, when we were not thinking logically, when perhaps a degree of selfishness comes into things when you're tired, there's a danger that we would have argued about row harder rather than row safer. Luckily, we didn't have to have that conversation, and we decided not to change anything that we were doing. And actually, we got across in great order. Kian got a world record, and we were the professional team that we wanted to be. Yes, we probably could have rowed a bit faster. We finished in ninth overall, so we dropped back to ninth. But I think the most important thing is that we did it successfully, and that we de-risked injury and breakage by maintaining that sort of sense of unity throughout the row. So the final little bit, you know, we did it. Everyone wants the flare photo, but it was an amazing emotional experience coming in. I'll show you the final bit of video, but for the last few days, we were just talking about what we're going to do when we got home constantly. And it was a real extended high, anything from seeing friends and family again to what we're going to eat, to just getting off the damn boat. It was, yeah, we just wanted to do it all. So I'll play you the final little bit.
Get knocked. Oh my god.
These are our little messages from home, little words of inspiration.
This has just smacked itself into the boat.
Line fishing. Come story of
life. Different type of palm flat day today.
This is our view. Still as
anything. It's just us, the sea, and our own company. Now I'm a mile
away. Still rowing.
They're throwing me overboard.
Final week. A special moment on the trip now, the thing that we've dreamed about, been waiting for what seems like a lifetime. Because in the distance, what have we got?
And here we've got the Coast Guard coming up on the rib.
Yes.
Oh, excited.
I suppose final slide for me, we'll pause in a second because there might be a couple of questions, but it's a little bit of a cliched sort of motivational poster, isn't it? But it's really apt, and we use this to talk to schools and do school assemblies quite a lot. But I think it's that mindset approach to project management and any difficult task that you may have. We had this view that, yes, there's going to be everything that underpins this iceberg, you know, the hard work and the sacrifice and the discipline and all that sort of stuff. And there are lots of doubts, you know, but anything worth doing that is successful has to have all that with it. And I think we had this approach that any setback that we had was going to be celebrated as just another chapter that made the success all the more sweeter. So we didn't used to worry when things went wrong. We wouldn't get down about the failures and things breaking and things not coming off, because we always had this sense of belief that we were going to be successful at the end of it. So it just became a story, it became a chapter, it became a thing to reflect on that made the success part of it all that sweeter. So again, I think if you linking back to that mental resilience part of, you know, having faith in your project and that sense of belief, you know you're going to achieve it. You have to have that sort of outlook from the start that you can compartmentalize failure. You can compartmentalize when things don't go your right way and just be able to smile and think, yep, I'm going to be able to talk about this and how we overcome it when we achieve it all at the end. So I think I'm going to pause there. I had another couple of little clips to show, but they're not particularly relevant to this talk. So I'll stop. And then if anyone's got any questions, I'll gladly use the remaining time to answer them. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you, Richard. That was a great presentation, an awesome achievement. And the comments that are coming through right now, someone said, so proud of our army. Awesome achievement by you all. So I'll dive straight into the questions. So I think the number one question from everyone is, would you do it again?
Now I would. There's video evidence of all of us saying we are never doing this again. You know, one wave is the same as any other wave. So why would you go on and row the Pacific or the Indian or even do the Atlantic again? But actually, then when the misery of the sea and what it does to you subsides, you're left with the bit of the iceberg that you can see at the top. And that's what you reflect on. And I think I do miss part of that. And I do miss the project, the campaign, and bringing that to life and all the opportunities and doors it opened and people that I spoke to. And I think I miss the euphoria of just some of the nicer days at sea as well. But what I miss the most of all of it is having three other people that are with you on this journey, whose, in some ways, life is in your hands and your life is in theirs. And it's just having that bond forged in a common goal, a common purpose, and that you know that you're going to celebrate at the end of it all. There are things that you can do that are similar to it. But for me, this was a particular high, given, I think, the difficulty of it, but the success peak overall at the end of it does make me look back on it with quite a sense of romance. So it's a long-winded answer, but yes, I'll do it again.
Excellent. Brent has asked, and hopefully it's not a touchy subject, but he's asked, where did the Navy come in the end?
So the Navy beat us by 6 hours. They came, so we were ninth, I think they came seventh. So a lot of us all finished on the same day. I suspect had we nibbled away at them a bit more, they'd have just rowed harder to keep in front of us. And there's a danger that the whole thing would have been so miserable and it would have turned from an endurance event to a sprint endurance. And no one wants that. So I think, you know, they were four bigger, younger guys who had to beat the army. I think just us competing with our youngster, getting him across, that was our success story. So I'm glad we never lost focus at that.
No, true, very true. Brent has just commented to say he's ex-Navy, so although he's happy for you, he's very happy that the Navy beat you.
We're great friends with them. So we had a really good sort of joint campaign almost with them. You know, we stoked the inter-service rivalry with posters, and we'd wind each other up on social media, but it behind the scenes, it was all collaboratively done. And Hugo's become a really good friend of mine. He's hoping to row again himself as well. So, it brought out the best in both services.
Yeah, I can imagine. You mentioned and you showed that great slide about the project management, the three stages. Looking back, obviously you'd do it again, but any of the project management style, would you change anything? Ashok has asked.
I think I would change it because I've now got the experience of this subject. So where I talked about the kind of experimentation and fail fast, I perhaps wouldn't need to adopt so much of that as a strategy. I think I've got sounder principles on which to base a campaign. And probably I know areas where we could have tweaked and refined and gone a little bit better. So I think I'd have more structure and more milestones that I know were important milestones. And we had some on there that were just not, you know, they weren't gateways through which we had to step to keep the project on track. And again, that's a product of not quite understanding what isn't important at the start of a project. But I think project management principles absolutely apply to this. And I'm sort of pleased to say that we ended up turning a profit on this thing. We ended up with £20,000 at the end of it that we hadn't spent, which we then donated to the charity on top of the £40,000 that we'd raised. So I'm really proud that from a value for money and an economy perspective, it all kind of went in the right way. But I'd hate to have to fundraise in this COVID environment that we're in now. I think that would be a completely different proposition.
No, certainly, certainly. So the ideal project, you finished on time and you're underspent as well. So I'm sure there's some people in the audience that's applauding you for that as well. where's the boat now?
So the boat was chartered. We didn't actually buy it. And that was one of the things that I would change. It was the most expensive way of doing it. And had we bought the boat, we could have sold it almost for cost after the race. But we needed upfront funds, which we didn't have. So the boat was chartered. And actually, you may have seen a reality TV program called Don't Rock the Boat that was on last month, where they had two celebrity teams rowing up from the south coast up to Scotland. Well, the boat was that boat, or one of them anyway. So she's been on TV and she's entering the race this year with the crew that are just down the road from the college, a Royal Engineer crew from Ripon. So Victory, her name is, and she's going strong.
Oh, good news. Well, I'm glad it's getting reused again. I can see Andrew's joined us. Andrew, did you have any questions? I have got additional ones if need be.
Yeah, thanks, Robin. Thanks, Rich, very much. I want to just take you back to the start of what you were talking about, and you described how the initial commencement of the project was a distraction from the main role, not just for you, but for the team that you assembled. And I think that's a common experience that we all have when embarking on a new project, is that you've still probably got other things that you're responsible for and doing, or and even other multiple projects all on the go at the same time. So how did you find the prioritization of those competing demands and being able to plan far enough ahead as to when this would become the main focus as you neared the actual start date?
Yeah, it's a really good question. I think that is the bit that I worried about the most. And I still look back and wonder if the perception that people had, if I could have done more in that sense. So the reason I say that is that I thought everyone would get behind this straight away because they would be able to see why we were doing it, you know, for the army and for the college, and it was about a young person being given this opportunity to do something amazing. What I didn't bank on was perhaps a little bit of maybe professional jealousy and a little bit of, you know, you're always going to get some people that will look at things from a negative perspective, and social media is great for amplifying that. So there's me running a college of almost 2,000 people, high risk teenagers under lots of scrutiny, and at the same time swanning off in a boat across the Atlantic, having this jolly. So I perhaps a little bit naively thought I'd get I get universal backing, and I didn't. And I picked up on some of the grumblings quite early on. So the way I mitigated that, and as I became more and more involved in the project as we got close to the start line, was really is investing in the team, the college team that weren't rowing, to make sure that they had everything that they need in terms of independence and skills and confidence and delegations to run stuff and make decisions in my absence. I almost sort of factored in this transition period where I gradually stepped away from some of the more routine stuff that I'd be doing to allow them to do it while I was there and have the confidence to do it. And then it meant that right at the last moment, I could finally hand over to my deputy, and he was in charge for the minimum amount of period that I could get away with. So I think that worked quite well. And there's a more of a fundamental principle of, you know, investing in your team and developing your team, because if you're not away rowing, you're off sick, or you're on holiday, or you've got another project that lands that you've got to do and devote time to, or something else changes. So I think as a principle that works anyway. But yeah, I did fret over it. And maybe I'm a little bit sensitive like that anyway, that when someone criticizes my style or my technique, I perhaps dwell on it a bit too much. And actually sometimes you just have to realize that despite no matter how positive you are and how well you sell a vision, there'll be someone that just decides to take a diametrically opposed view, just because they do, and that's the way they are. So I think overall everyone was supportive, and certainly when I got back, there was a real kind of buzz about what we'd achieved and what Kian had achieved. But I think there was a bit of nervousness before I went about the reasons why we're doing it, and was I in the right place as a leader and a commander. And I still probably not completely sure that I was in the right place, and whether I should have been on that boat. But I think without me, it wouldn't have happened in the first place. So you can't really win with that one.
Andrew, any additional questions?
Yeah, loads, but we'll probably need to have a beer on a different occasion for questions. I think. Yeah, I was obviously was going to pick up another point that you mentioned as well about, and in my words rather than yours, Rich, the responsibility of social value in project management is that it touches on what you talk about there about the aims and why you were doing that. But how I'm interested in that reflection of how the social value, which is now particularly around public procurement, such a key part of how we are required to deliver projects, was the practical aspect of rowing across the ocean is different to the value that you're trying to create, and that that demonstration of what a young person entering the military is capable of achieving, of the balance of that in that preparation and messaging as to how it aligns with what you were just saying about the narrative. But how did you reflect or recognize that was such a key component of the project management bit, the 70% you described before you actually set off?
Yeah, I guess that's a really good observation. I don't know how I did it. I think maybe I just had this gut feel that the college was a special place. And, you know, I was drinking from the college every day, looking at what people were achieving, having come from nothing. Like the most extreme example is, yeah, the junior regimental sergeant major is the best of his intake or her intake. He commands the parade at the end, which is the second largest military parade in the UK and the largest graduation parade in Europe. It's massive, 5,000 spectators. Second only to Troop in the Colour. And we develop a young man or woman to be able to take that parade and bellow out words of command under all that pressure. And it's that, to me, is the embodiment of this 12 months of training and transformation they go through. And I almost, even now, I have a lump in my throat when I think of the journeys and the changes that some of these young men and women have gone through. So I was drinking from that every day. So I probably, through osmosis, had this view that whatever I was going to do and we were going to do, it had to have that front and center. I suppose what I hadn't banked on is that sort of social statement became so powerful in itself. I'm pretty sure that was the sole reason 90% of the sponsors got on board. As I mentioned, you know, it wasn't, they weren't paying for advertising on a boat the same way that someone pays for advertising on a racing car. They were giving us money because they loved the idea of what we were trying to do with this young person. So, you know, Kian became he was a focal point of the campaign. I think had he not been there, it had just been four army blokes rowing the ocean the same way that four army blokes can climb mountains or trek to remote places or go on operations. I don't think I'd have any romance. It wouldn't have the cachet. And actually, some people would have poked fun of it and said, what a waste of taxpayers' money. So I was really keen to avoid all that part of it as well. And I think, again, as you mentioned, that the social capital invested in the row was justification perhaps for me as a leader and a commander to not be in the traditional place that you'd have found me in December and January, and actually increasingly in the months leading up to it as well. But yeah, he was fundamental. And there are teams really struggling this year to raise sponsorship. There are two military teams, ocean rowing teams, on the go at the moment, both struggling. And COVID aside, I think part of the reason they're struggling is they don't have the narrative of, you know, development and opportunity for young people that we do. Their stories are less compelling from the off. So I think any project that looks at that and identifies its USP just has a broader foundation of success to build on right from the start.
Yeah, I'm sure everybody on the call here would recognize that in terms of understanding the narrative around their project as well. And I think, Rob, if I can indulge and allow one last question, I'm not sure if you've got any others that are online, but finishing up, Rich, the you talked about the sharing and collaboration across the teams, and right there sort of on the start line, that everybody was willing to share their experience to get to that point, and actually everybody wanted all other teams to be successful, maybe in slightly different positions within the race, but everybody to complete it safely. And I think the message around safety is a key one around project management as well. But I'm just wondering, in that and what you've described about Kian's experience and the values there, what's the two-way share between the army and between project management in terms of what we can learn from each other, and is that reflected now in the roles that you've gone into or the projects that you get involved in, of how that integration can happen better because there is such a commonality between the approach the military takes to its planning, its operations, and project management as a discipline? And I just wonder what your reflection on sharing in that environment might be.
Yeah, I think there's an absolute synergy between sort of, you know, traditional project, formal project management, call it what you will, and the way the military goes about solving problems. I think actually so the military decision making process, it's also known as the combat estimate or the seven questions. There's lots of different ways of sort of describing it, but it's founded on solving problems on operations with forces aligned against an enemy trying to achieve an objective. And in some ways, that process doesn't really fit what most of us spend our time doing, which is managing projects. You know, very few of us command soldiers and operations and actually have to come up with plans to not get them killed and win. So I think we're looking at formal project management as a way of helping us solve our daily day-to-day business. And I'm sure if I told you what I do now, sat behind a desk typing away on a computer leading a team of people, it would be no different to probably every single person on this call. The nature of the work is slightly different ultimately at the sharp end, but again, what underpins it, and I suppose all that iceberg stuff, what underpins that is the same project management that you would understand and know. So I think there's absolute synergy there. And I suppose in some ways that's why the army did say yes, go ahead and do it, and we did market it this in a way of our own leadership development and horizon broadening and bringing the project to life would be great, and it is. You know, lots of stuff I will take from this and map into other things that I get my hands on. Some of it you can't put your finger on, and some of it you absolutely can. Yeah, you can refine a campaign plan and do a better version of it. And there are other things that you learn just through experience and emotional involvement with team members. It probably boils down to a phrase called leadership. But yeah, I think there's lots of similarities between the way we work and formal project management.
Great, thanks very much, Rich. Rob, I don't know if there's any further questions that have been posted that you've picked up on.
No additional questions.
Excellent. So I think we will close there. I think that, Rich, is absolutely fantastic and fascinating, and what an inspiration. And well, congratulations to you and the team. And I think you really have achieved what you set out to in terms of promoting the values of all of the young people that go through the Army Foundation College. And it's an inspiration to us all. And I hope for all of those that have been on the call, they're inspired by the story, and they can reflect on a lot of those lessons learned and the application in their own projects. And particularly, I think, picking up on your last point there on leadership in a challenging environment, and how we create teams that, when the chips are down, you've set the parameters of how you're going to work together and be successful when you've got to make difficult decisions in challenging circumstances. And that's all scalable. It doesn't matter what project you're working on. You may have been at the very far end of that spectrum while in the middle of the ocean and rolling in the waves, but even on the projects we're all collectively involved in as a project community, those skills and those lessons are valuable to us all. So thank you very much on behalf of our Yorkshire and North Lincolnshire branch of APM, and for all of the people on the call, thank you for attending. And we look forward to seeing you again.
Thank you very much. Absolute pleasure. Thank you.